Mr. President, thank you for the time.
Thank you.
1 year since the Lehman collapse, mm-hmm. Wall Street's making money again, but Congress hasn't moved on your regulatory reform overhaul. Some on Wall Street are saying that it's lost some steam. What's your response?
Oh, I think it's got a lot of steam because the American people understand that this needs to happen. I understand it needs to happen. I think that the chairman, Barney Franks and Chris Dodd, know that it needs to happen. And so I'm very optimistic about us getting a set of rules in place that prevent the kind of crisis that we're seeing from happening again.
This year?
And prevent taxpayers from being placed in the kind of position that they were placed in last year, which said either you watch the economy and collapse and the financial system melt down, or you've got to pony up hundreds of billions of dollars to Wall Street. I think that can't be the two choices we have. That's why we need reform.
Well, you had some pretty harsh words for Wall Street today. Reckless behavior, mm-hmm. quick kills, bloated bonuses. Who specifically were you talking about?
Read the papers. Read the financial
specific firms, individuals?
Well, I'm not going to get into specific firms or individuals. I think we're all aware of the fact that there has been a culture that rewards short-term thinking, that used leverage to take exorbitant risks that were unsustainable for the system as a whole. I don't think that's because any single individual or firm was bad. I mean, there are exceptions like the Bernie Madoffs who were just out-and-out crooks. But I think what you had was a situation in which people felt that unless I take these same exorbitant risks and with huge leverage, then I'm going to fall behind. My bonuses are going to be smaller. People are not going to want to do business with my firm. And that's the culture, I think, that we've got to reverse. Not to squelch innovation or creativity, but to make sure that we don't get into what's called a moral hazard problem, where people assume that government's there as a backstop, and so you stop making good, sound economic decisions, and you're rolling the dice with other people's money and ultimately with the American economy.
Well, some of these same banks, they're fighting hard to kill your proposal for mm-hmm. a consumer financial protection agency.
Right.
Would you sign a bill if it's not in it?
Well, you know, I never answer these questions about will you sign a bill with this in it or that in it, because obviously we're still far away from seeing a final package.
But could they succeed in killing it?
But I don't think they're going to succeed in killing it, and I'm going to do everything I can to stop them from killing it. Here's why. The problem we had in part was the lack of systemic oversight. We saw each firm individually, but we didn't see how, if that firm fails, that could lead to AIG going, that could lead to a whole range of problems, not just here in the United States, but around the world. So we want to have a systemic risk regulator. We've got to have an ability to unwind one firm and do that in a self-contained way, what's called resolution authority. Those are important. We need increased capital requirements for companies that are right now considered too big to fail. Let's make sure that they're not put in a position where they might fail and make sure that they can weather economic storms so that we don't have to step in. But we also have to understand that part of this crisis had to do with the fact that people don't understand some of the financial instruments that were being peddled out there. Subprime mortgages, credit card debt that people are accumulating, and suddenly they find that teaser rates are translating into 30% interest rates, and they can never pay them back. So we need a consumer financial protection agency that consolidates the tasks of all these different agencies right now, nobody who has central responsibility for that area. That will help the American consumer and ultimately will allow good, solid business practices to be rewarded in ways that right now they're not always rewarded.
Well, you mentioned the systemic risk regulator, mm-hmm. and some Democrats, from Jack Reed to Barney Frank to Chris Dodd, mm-hmm. they say that the Fed shouldn't be granted all that power, and they back Sheila Bair's proposal to spread that out among a council of regulators. Yeah. Would you support that?
Well, what I've said, and I said repeated in the speech today, is we should have a council where everybody
but
is coordinating.
But it still leaves the Fed fully accountable for
because
the...
Because what you ultimately have to have is one person or one institution or entity that is making clear decisions at the end of the day. the buck has to stop with someone. And I think that the Fed is best equipped to do this.
With upcoming G20, executive compensation is going to be a big issue among global bankers. Yeah. Why doesn't the U.S. support limits on compensation across the industry?
Well, I have been a strong proponent, even before this first crisis, of making sure that shareholders have some say in compensation for their executives. And I am a strong believer that part of the way that we need to change Wall Street's culture is to reward long-term performance as opposed to short-term profits. So those principles are ones that I want enshrined in Wall Street practices. But this has been a country where, as a general proposition, we don't go around saying you can't pay people whatever the market will bear.
Even
in
after the
private
government
sector.
Gives $300 billion.
Well, no, but that's
that's
a different situation. I mean, we've been very clear that if you're taking taxpayer money, then we get to call some of the shots on this. Taxpayers have to be protected. But the kinds of proposals that we've seen out there extends beyond a situation where the government is asked money. It would extend across an industry generally. And so then you have to start asking yourself, well, why is it that we're going to cap executive compensation for Wall Street bankers, but not Silicon Valley entrepreneurs or NFL football players? And you know, that's just not how our market has operated. I think the best check that we have on this these practices is to make sure that shareholders and investors actually have a say in terms of how bonuses and compensation work, and that we're setting up rules of the road so that these institutions can't make enormous profits simply on taking unwarranted risks and then somehow reward those who are taking those risks even when they fail.
Well, turning to the economy, economists surveyed by Bloomberg last week put the odds of a double-dip recession at 25%. Mm-hmm. What are you seeing that makes you confident that this recovery is going to be sustainable?
Well, I don't think we're out of the woods yet, but here's what we're seeing. Some movement in the positive direction on not just the economy as a whole, but also on in manufacturing. You've seen steady declines in the number of people who are losing their job each month. Obviously, that's no relief for the people who have lost their jobs, but at least that we're seeing a bottoming out and that potentially we could start seeing some positive job growth. It is encouraging that we've seen trade start to improve around the world, including exports from the United States to other countries. So all the indicators would tend to suggest that we're starting to see growth. Now, what we have to be careful about is taking the crutches away from the patient too early. And if you look at the history of the Great Depression, some of the initial actions taken by FDR when he came in were fairly successful in boosting growth. The government immediately then took away a lot of those programs because of concerns, legitimate concerns about deficit spending, and that plunged the economy back into a second very deep recession. We have to make sure that we avoid that pattern. And so, you know, Tim Geithner, Larry Summers, Christina Romer, and the rest of my economic team are constantly feeding me with the information we need to monitor it. We want to get out of some of these extraordinary interventions as quickly as possible, but not so soon that the recovery doesn't take flight.
We mentioned that trade's picking up. China now, though, they're threatening to retaliate for the tariffs on Chinese tires. When you meet with President Hu Jintao next week, what are you going to say to him to avoid this escalating into a trade war?
Well, we're not going to see a trade war. I think that there are some tensions around this, no doubt about it. But my message is very simple. We have rules on the books. And if I simply ignore those rules, if there's a surge in cheap tires here in the United States and I don't exercise the tools that were written into the trade agreements that we have, then I'm not going to have a lot of credibility with the American people or with Congress the next time I go up there and want to expand trade with another country, because their attitude will be, you know, these agreements aren't worth the paper that they're written on. We've got to establish credibility and enforcement of the rules, precisely because I want to further expand trade in the future. And that is something that I think the Chinese government should understand.
Let's talk about healthcare, $900 billion, and let's get into some of the specifics. The first two-thirds, you're going to save hundreds and billions of dollars in waste, fraud, and abuse from the system. But some Democrats are asking for you to send a bill to Congress that actually spells that out. Is that something that you would do?
Well, we are seeing progress with the Senate Finance Committee, which probably has which has primary jurisdiction over how to pay for things in the Senate. We're going to let that work its way through the process. Here's my very simple principle. We're going to make sure that this does not add a dime to the deficit. I want to sign a bill that does so. We have sent already a range of options to make sure that this is adequately paid for. As you said, the vast bulk of how we're going to pay for it is money that's already in the healthcare system. The taxpayers are already ponying up. It's just being spent badly. So we want to make sure that it's spent wisely to improve care, to make sure that everybody has access. But there is no doubt that over the next several weeks, there are going to be times where we need to walk Congress through some difficult areas there.
Will you go up
and,
there?
And I will be happy to use my office and my own time and energy anywhere that's appropriate in order to get this thing done. And the reason is because if we don't get this done, not only are you still going to see 30 million American citizens without health insurance, not only are people who have health insurance going to be vulnerable to suddenly having their insurance dropped because of arbitrary decisions by insurance companies, but I also will not be able to get a handle on our long-term deficit. Everybody agrees with this, that Medicare is by far the biggest driver of our deficit. If we can't bring down those costs, then all those people out there who say they're concerned about the deficit, I have to send them a message. We are not going to be able to get it under control. The amount of money that goes into Medicare dwarfs all these other decisions that we're talking about.
Well, on the revenue side, one-third, $300 billion you have to raise. You endorsed a tax on Cadillac insurance plans. That's only going to bring in around $100 billion. Where do you get that other $200 billion?
Well, as I said, I mean, we've provided a long list, and right now members of Congress are looking over the details of those proposals.
But some of what's been outlined in the Finance Committee's plan,
some of those are attractive options. And
the health savings account.
I think the key is to make sure that as much as possible, we get these dollars out of the existing healthcare system, because first of all, it means that we're spending those healthcare dollars more wisely. What that also allows us to do then is, if there are savings to be had outside of healthcare, we can look to devote to deficit reduction in the future.
Now, one last question. Mm-hmm. Next month, in Copenhagen, the Olympic Committee is going to make the decision for 2016. Many have credited Tony Blair's pitch with bringing home the bacon for the London Olympics. Right. Are you that confident that Chicago can get this, that you don't have to go yourself?
You know, I would love to go because Chicago's my hometown. The track and field stadium, if we got the Olympics here in the United States, would actually be about three blocks from my house, so I could walk over and watch. I don't know if
you're not still living.
I don't know if Usain Bolt will still be running at that time, but we are deeply invested in getting this done. Michelle is definitely planning to go to Copenhagen, and she's, I think, the best Obama representative that we have. I'm in the middle of some very important decisions around healthcare. We are obviously still working on the issue of financial regulation. It may not be a time where I can just devote a couple of days to fly over there.
Still a chance?
Oh, I think that we have a great chance of Chicago
getting. No, you going?
Getting, I think, as I said, Michelle's our best representative.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.